let's give a huge round of applause to this wonderful lady. This is saxophonist Rhoda G out there in St. Louis.
Yes. See that arch right there? Thank you so much.
You are most welcome. So how are you doing?
Oh man, I'm doing all right.
Good. It's so wonderful to have you here at the Smooth Jazz Lounge.
Well, it's wonderful to be here, and I want you to know I was nervous, like I was going to London today.
I want to say a big thank you to Michelle Sellers. If it wasn't for her, I would not know about you.
That's my girl.
So I saw you perform at one of her events, which I saw online.
Yes.
And I was just totally impressed with your stage presence.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, and your comedy.
Yeah, I'm quite really goofy.
I think you are just an amazing, amazing artist. So tell us, when did you start playing the sax?
I was 13, about to turn 14. And I've always known I wanted to play the sax. I think around fourth grade, they stuck me on clarinet, and I think I had it for like 2 weeks because I knew that wasn't the sound that I wanted. So eventually, my dad ended up getting me a sax, right before I turned 14, and it was actually the same week I lost my mom. So I think that's what made it so much more significant,
mm-hmm.
and that's why I never put it down, because that's.
Yeah. How did you know you wanted to play the sax? Have you heard other saxophonists?
Not so much as other saxophonists. It was the music my mom and dad played around the house. My dad was more of a Temptation Whisper type guy. And every time a saxophone came in, I was like, what is that sound? And then my mom had Luther Vandross and Anita Baker. And, you know, so every time... All those songs with sax, I knew them verbatim, the lyrics, but I was listening at that saxophone. I'm like, oh my gosh.
Mm-hmm. So at the age of 14, you had your first sax. Did you have lessons?
No.
No, you're self-taught.
You know what was my lesson? Church.
Right.
Yeah, I went and sat in the corner and figured it out.
Did you?
Until I was ready to hit a microphone.
And when was that?
Oh man, long time.
Remember your first gig?
I don't. I can't. You know what? I can't. I can say I remember my first gig, but not like my first, like church performance. If that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Cause that's where I started. So, and I actually started on drums.
Did you?
Yeah.
Okay. So why did you not continue with the drums?
Well, at the time when I started teaching myself drums, we didn't have a drummer at the church. But by the time I stopped drumming, I thought I was going to be drumming on somebody's head because we had too many drummers. So right. We ended up fighting over songs, and I'm like, this is not going to work. I need my own instrument.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody wanted the jam songs, and nobody wanted to play the slow songs. So, yeah. I begged.
You didn't study music.
I did 2 years in college, and I did study music performance.
Okay.
Unfortunately, the college I went to didn't have a band.
Right.
So the performance part for me was singing and piano.
You sing as well?
No. I got an A+ in the course, though, because me and the instructor... Man, I sung in German, French, and Spanish, and I don't, yeah.
What?
Man, it's all a blur.
Oh. So when you were studying jazz, or sorry, when you was doing music at school, were you studying traditional jazz, like your Dizzy Gillespie's and artists like that?
No, I actually never studied jazz, per se.
Not?
Nope, never really studied the little music theory that I did get, like I said, it was from vocal classes and piano classes.
Mm-hmm.
So I never really, and it was just really basic things like, you know, Mary Had a Little Lamb. And then too, when I went back to school, I had already taught myself. So it's kind of hard when you're a self-taught musician to go back and try to learn the correct way. And, you know, like my embouchure, I have a really bad embouchure where I bite my lip, and I know I'm not supposed to do that. And I've tried to change it over the years, but there's no changing it.
No.
I just got to put this thing on my teeth and keep it moving.
Oh, I see. And so when you was, you know, practicing the sax as a young person, was you playing along to your parents' music?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's how I taught myself, by listening to music. You know, I can read a little bit, but not sight read like that. So if you really want me to learn something, just put it on CD, and I got you. Promise you.
So who are your inspirations?
I would say my first ever instrumental inspiration would be Kenny G.
Okay. Is that where you get the G from, your name?
No, my last name actually starts with a G. And I know a lot of people think that about Rhoda G, but no. And I play the soprano mostly. Yeah, I know.
So but you play the soprano just like Kenny G?
Yeah, yep.
Yeah.
I just like the sweet sound of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I was actually watching a clip about him, Kenny G, and how he is like the smooth jazz king. Do you agree with that?
Oh, yeah. Smooth? Yeah.
Yeah.
Kenny G, Najee, Grover, all them guys are just phenomenal.
Yeah. And so do you tend to gear towards saxophonists, like within smooth jazz, or do you like other artists that don't play the sax?
You know, I gravitate to top 40, so it's not really...
Top 40?
Top 40, yeah. And it's not... It's not jazz top 40, let's just say that. So I play a lot of pop, a lot of, you know, R&B, a lot of just top 40 stuff, you know. Michael Jackson, Bruno Mars, you know, Stevie Wonder, all the greats. So I got, my repertoire.
You have to know all of those songs because you perform at weddings.
Yeah.
Events.
Yep.
Yeah, so it's good to have a knowledge of all those kind of tracks.
Oh, yeah, because you never know what audience you're going to get in front of.
Mm-hmm.
And I like to say that I think I'm prepared for, I've been put in some situations, let's just say. Yes, ma'am. And I start sweating, you know, when I got in the door, but, you know, hey, like I said, I got something for everybody. So we was all right. By the time the end of the night, I was getting money put in my hand. So,
really?
That's how I go. Yes.
So shall we have a song from you?
A song already?
Yeah.
No, I was just... I'm
what
totally
fine.
What
are you going to do for us?
I don't know. What you want? You got to tell me when you want me to play the single. We could save that for later.
But... Yeah, we'll save that for later.
Okay. Yeah. So, when I do shows, I usually start off a little mellow because, you know, I'm on the plus size, sad. So, you know, we're going to be on here for a little while. So, we're going to start off with something a little mellow. Is that all right?
Yeah, that'd be wonderful. Thank you.
All right, let's take a walk.
She should be on the stage, shouldn't she?
I agree. Thank you.
That was sensational. You're getting a lot of love out here right now.
Oh, thank you. I'm sweating right now. I shouldn't have put this sweat on. Well, not. Oh, I don't get no break, no man.
You said you was going to start off nice and easy, but look at that.
Look at that. I thought long walk was going to be nice and breezy. I guess not.
Well, that was that was amazing. Empress Leach, like, wow, play that thing, girl. Laurie Williams, she also said play. Enrique says excellent. Buenos Fido.
Jill Scott, that's my girl.
But I think it's a good thing. It is amazing.
I'm cool with Absolutely Wicked. You know, I'm a Halloween baby.
But do you not find that in the smooth jazz genre that it's predominantly males that play the saxophone?
Oh, yeah. Although, you know, this during quarantine this year, I have, well, not met, but I've been introduced to a whole lot more female saxophonists on social media. So I'm like, hey, I'm not the only one out here.
Yeah, please send them my way.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
I know a few, but not enough.
Oh, well,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to know a few more.
I mean, I know a few now, so that's a lot for me. I thought I was, like, my name, Rhoda. Only a few. I get called Rhonda all the time.
Oh, yeah, I bet you do. Mm. So if you could open up for any artist, who would that be?
Oh, my God. Bruno Mars.
Really?
Hands down. Hands down. 24 karat, yes. And I wouldn't even want to, I just want to play with him.
Mm-hmm.
He got a cold horn section, but I mean, I'll just see what
I can do. I'll put a good word in for you.
Hey, nah, that's what I'm talking about. Yes.
And do you class yourself as a professional musician? Or do you have a day job as well?
Nope. No day job for me. This is it, Michael Jackson.
Did you ever have a day job?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you did?
Yes, ma'am. I've done it all. Mm-hmm. From corporate to driving the kids to school.
Oh.
Oh, yes.
But now as a full-time musician, how has it been during this lockdown?
Oh, horrible.
I can imagine.
I'm trying to tell you, meeting you was the highlight of my year.
Oh.
Not saying that if I wasn't locked down, it still wouldn't have been the highlight. Let me get that straight. But, you know, yeah, this kind of saved me a little bit because it's been a rough year. Yeah. I played outside this summer and I do not do bugs. Period.
Tell us about that.
Or heat.
Outside event. That is Michelle Sellers' event, right? So her car park.
Oh yeah, hers and everybody else's. I didn't have one indoor gig this year.
All right. So how was it playing in the car park to people that are quite far away from you?
Oh, it was awesome.
Yeah.
You know, I got a wireless mic, so I can still walk up on the cars.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you know, I'm not gonna even lie. I like the horns better than the claps.
Oh.
Until they start trying to hit that note with me. Then I'm like, okay, you know, I ain't gonna even give you no jump if your battery died, because you shouldn't have been on your horn like that. Let me cover that. You know, so, yeah, I had somebody do that on the last on the last show. He was, hurring. I was like, okay, you're gonna need a jump. Yeah. But other than that, man, it was one of my greatest, you know, one of the steady gigs I had this summer, mm-hmm. as well as one of the best gigs.
When I saw it was just amazing. You know, everybody with their fancy classic cars,
the
smooth jazz playing, and you know, they've got their drinks, they've got their food. I thought it was a fantastic idea, and you know, we wouldn't be able to do something like that over here in the UK because we're not guaranteed good weather. Yeah, I guess you're fortunate to have that good weather out there during that time.
I'd say sort of, kinda.
Because
I always talk about St. Louis weather being like the people. Mm-hmm. It's kind of bipolar. So one day we'll have snow And then the next day, you know, you want to put on some shorts. Right. And thus leaving us sick, thinking we got corona. Because, yeah, St. Louis weather is, yeah, we in the Midwest. We're like right in the middle. We get it all. So.
Well, whenever I saw it, the sun was shining on you, on all of you guys in St. Louis.
You caught us on the good days.
Yeah.
Because what was that, yesterday or the day before, we woke up to snow flurries, and I'm like, I'm not ready. Not yet. Even though snow days don't mean much now that since we homeschooling.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
So let's talk about your latest single that you released. That's your first single that you've released.
It's the latest and first, yes. Mm-hmm. But definitely not the last, because I'm working on some stuff.
Good. I'm glad to hear
yes,
that.
Yes. But the single, finally, is available everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It's doing really well. I appreciate you for playing it. I be listening. I chime in. I'm like, yes, okay. So, and then I get, you know, updates. So, it's doing pretty well, and I'm pretty thankful. It's the one thing that kind of made this year not so bad, mm-hmm. you know.
And you released that this year.
Hmm?
When was that you released it?
October 1st.
October the 1st. That's quite recently.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. A couple of months.
And why did you call it finally?
Because that's how I felt. I know the first studio session I had was a year prior to me releasing it. And when I went back to the studio, he was like, oh, finally. I was like, you sure right. That's what we go call it.
Oh.
Because he was waiting on me to come back, but I was working. I had a job last year.
Right.
So the only job I've had in like 10 years. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah, but it was in order because it saved me this year because I had no idea.
Yeah. So what is your music creation like?
What is my music creation like?
Yeah. So, like, where do you get your inspirations for your tracks?
Well, that just depends on who I sit down and work with.
Right.
And what kind of creative juices flowing that day.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Since I'm self-taught, I don't have a specific, I guess, style per se. I don't even consider... Well, I'm a saxophonist that automatically puts me in the jazz genre.
Mm-hmm.
But because I play like Maroon 5 and, you know, Bruno Mars mm-hmm. and, you know, Usher and, you know, I don't play like jazz. So yeah. It's like, it's kind of hard to explain what I do because, mm-hmm. you know, I'm automatically put in this genre, you know?
Yeah.
So I love jazz, though.
Creation, though, do you have to like kind of decide on what the drum sequence is going to be like and what the guitars is going to be like and all of that?
Oh, no.
No, does somebody else do that for you?
Yeah, I'm not on the like produce side. Mm-hmm. I'm kind of like just, you know, I get my input and, you know, as a soloist, you improv anyway. You know what I'm saying? So mm-hmm. it's kind of just, like I said, you know, I leave that side to the professionals as far as the production and, you know, the producing the different sounds and beats. And because mm-hmm. mine's a sound like it came off that look first Casio that came out. And we don't want that. We'll be Hustle and Flow Part 2. You know it's hard out here. Yeah. Trying to tell you.
So shall we hear finally?
You'd like to hear finally?
I would
sure.
love to hear finally.
Let's do it.
Right here at the Smooth Jazz Lounge.
It back.
are a very energetic performer.
Oh man, in a hoodie too. I'm about to pass out over here.
Is your merchandise for sale?
Nope.
No.
It need to be, don't it?
Yeah, I love it. You wear it well.
Why, thank you, because you don't want to see what's under here. So I had to go pick it up the other day. I tried to get it together. Then I thought about putting these headphones on top of it. Oh, my gosh.
Oh.
We went viral today in a different kind of way.
That was your fabulous track, Finally.
Yes.
And I want to tell everybody where they can get it. Because everyone should be buying it. We need to support these artists right now.
Spotify, Amazon, iTunes, Apple Music. And if you ain't got a dollar, you could just go listen to it on YouTube.
Oh, yeah. You got a YouTube channel.
Yeah, we can get that view too.
Yeah, wonderful. Do you have a video for it?
Nope.
No. If you could have a video for that, what would it be?
I don't know.
You haven't thought about that.
We ain't out the quarantine. You know what?
Nowadays.
I'm gonna do a video for the next single. See, because hopefully by then we'll be out this quarantine.
Right.
See, I can't think about a video and thinking finally until I get up out of here.
Yeah. So you're working on your new single right now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Are you collaborating with anybody?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. I don't know if he want me to put his name out there yet. I think he's trying to be a ghostwriter, for real.
Okay.
Because he like, I don't know. But when I tell you he is dope, Oh, my God. And that's what I kind of want, you know, to work with somebody who's young and full of, you know, creative juices and, you know, yeah.
Yeah. It makes sense, doesn't it? Getting that young blood in, you know, because it's... younger people are the ones that are buying the music, that they're listening to the music.
Yeah.
Yeah. Unless it's like, you know, smooth jazz, then it's my age group and higher.
And then it's a little harder because the older, you know, generations aren't really computer savvy. So like even with my dad, like he knows how to use YouTube. He can pull it up on YouTube, but I dare not try to direct him on how to download it over the phone.
Yeah. Mm-mm.
And his stuff set up on my account, so
right.
he be then ordered the whole every Finally out there. Yeah. so that part is super unfortunate, I think, as far as the jazz genre, because it's more older, you know. Yeah. Older you know.
And they must be feeling it as well, because they would love to be out at a performance seeing you guys perform.
My God. Man, that's the jazz festivals and it.
Yeah. And my mum, she's 80 and she loves dancing. You know, she loves being out. And I find it so frustrating for her. So I'll have a Zoom call with her and I'll play music and we dance and we drink and we have a great time. Yeah, well, she's good. She does Zoom. She does Facebook. She does everything.
That's awesome, man. The fact that you still have your mom. That anybody still got their mom, I just love them even more.
Oh.
I'm going to have to meet her one day.
Yeah, you will do.
We first got on the call and you said, how you doing? You know, I don't know if they say it over there. You know, how you doing? How your mama doing? But, you know, I don't say it a lot because, you know, my mom has been gone since 93. So, but, yeah, man, that's awesome. Give her a hug and a kiss for me.
No, I will do when I get to see her.
Yes,
ma'am.
I also
want to say happy anniversary to you.
Ha ha, 1 year.
So, Rhoda G got married a year ago.
Yes, on Monday. It was Cyber Monday. We celebrated 1 year.
That is just amazing. It's so, so wonderful. So, if there was any venue that you could perform in all over the world, anywhere, where would it be?
Madison Square Gardens.
Ooh.
Well, you said the world. I don't know. But here, I know Madison Square Garden. That's definitely
nice.
Yeah, that'd be super nice.
Yeah. Let me know when that happens.
I know. I did the Apollo, so that was like a super...
The Apollo.
A super duper dream in Harlem, New York. I won first place twice and second place once.
And what was that for?
Oh, the amateur night competition.
Mm-hmm. For any artist, or was this in smooth.
Oh yeah, it's any artist, any talent. It's like that. It's like a talent show.
Mm-hmm.
So if you go out there and you do bad, you can get booed off.
Oh yeah, so, we have something similar over here.
And that's what they're known for, because they have a man called Sandman come out. Well, Sandman gone.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so that's the whole gist of the Apollo Theater. Yeah, you get booed off. Thank God I ain't get booed off, because y'all probably wouldn't be seeing me today.
So what did you play then?
That's What I Like by Bruno Mars.
Oh, did you?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh.
Got me first place.
Fantastic. That, I think, deserves one of these.
Yes.
Yeah, that's incredible. Well done, you. So what about performing here in London?
Oh, man, it's coming.
It's coming.
Yeah, we're going to make that happen. Me and you.
We are.
Yes, we are.
Rhoda G loves London that much. She called her daughter London.
There you go. My daughter's name is spelt just like London. I didn't put no Y in there or none of that crazy stuff. Yeah.
So what's your love for London? Why? That's London here, not your daughter.
Oh. I was finna say, because she was in my stomach. No. You know, I've always wanted to travel to London. That's you know, hands down. Mm-hmm. But let me tell you how I came up with her name. The 2012 Olympics was there. And she was in my belly at the time, so I sat on the I'm talking about, I had to get rid of the couch after, you know, the Olympics was over, because I put a good dent in it sitting there watching the Olympics. So that year, Gabrielle was jamming, so I was like, well, maybe I should name her Gabby. And I was like, nah. So then I was like, London. And they kept saying, London 20. I'm like, okay, yeah, London it is. So, yeah. But she, I'm telling you, she's going to make it to where we go to London at least once.
Yes. She has to.
Yes.
Yeah. You never know, 2021, it could happen then.
Yeah. Or 2022. We ain't going to rush it, you know. Everything is about time, and we going to let Corona get on out the way.
This is very true.
Oh, my God. This is, man, I feel so bad for everybody. You know, in the hospitals working, I'm just getting ready to set up with something with the children's hospital here virtually. So I'm excited about that, because usually I'll go to the hospital, children's hospitals during Christmas time and perform, like, you know, the Frozen songs and the Moanas. You know, my daughter, she keep me up on everything. So
yeah.
I learned all those songs too. And it's just the feeling to see a kid in excruciating pain.
Yeah.
Get some kind of pleasure out of, you know, hearing their favorite tunes.
Oh, that is a beautiful thing that you do. And sadly, yeah, you're not going to be able to do that this year. Were you going to try and do it maybe on Zoom with them? So they can.
Yeah, that's where we're setting up some virtual.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is so lovely. That really is. And I want to also say it's going to be London's birthday on Friday. So happy birthday.
Saturday.
On Saturday. So happy birthday to London. And what are you going to be doing with her?
We got a parade set up for her. That's about it.
Yeah. Oh, that is wonderful. So, yeah. We all wish her happy birthday.
My sister walking
Saturday.
By. Saturday. We can see your shadow.
Yeah,
that's all.
I saw her.
Oh, she waved.
you must have some Christmas music in your repertoire.
Oh, my God.
Do you have one for us today?
I don't think I do. See, what had happened was, let me tell you. I had all my music in Google Music, like Google Play, and they ended it. So I had to hurry up and try to figure out how to play in YouTube Music, all my playlists and everything didn't come over.
Aww.
I wish you would have told me that. I'll make sure I had one.
Don't worry. We're going to be doing this again, no doubt.
Okay.
Actually, yeah, next year, Christmas.
Well, I got one that sounds Christmas-y. But it's not. I was going to dedicate it to everybody we lost this year.
Yeah, yeah, could you play that for us right now? That'd be wonderful. Yeah,
dedicated to everybody we lost this year. I think everybody I know lost somebody this year. That's horrible.
Yeah.
Rather it was due to whatever, you know. It's, yeah. But we gonna make it through. So this is for them.
Okay. Thank you. Amazing.
I apologize for the volumes. I just acquired this skill this year.
All right. But the thing is, with you, you don't you don't miss a note. You know, every note is sounds just absolutely perfect.
What?
Yeah.
I just messed up about 27 times.
I didn't hear it.
It's this sweater. No. But yeah, I appreciate that, man. I mean, because artists, we are our worst critics. I mean, like,
I know you guys can be, yeah.
But then with the sound,
and it's beautiful. I love it. Kevin Dartner, he says, wow, beautiful. And I also want to say quick, it's going to be Laverne James's birthday on Saturday as well. She's right here on the Zoom
event. Happy birthday, Laverne.
Oh,
yes.
So yeah, no, that was amazing. So we're going to have a little, you know, one more thing I want you to tell everybody is how you hold that note. Tell us about that you hold.
Did you want me to hold the note today?
Wait, no, because we're going to be running out of time.
Oh, man. Oh, I should have held it on that one.
I thought you were going to then.
No, I was, but then I had my finale song. I didn't know.
Oh, you got another song to do?
Yeah, I was going to end it on that Bruno. They got me first place.
Oh, that's going to happen then. That is going to happen.
Can we do 2 minutes over?
Yeah, we can. Yeah, we have to.
We got to do this. What Jim, I like.
Jimmy's asking the same question I asked you the other day. What's the longest?
Oh, yep, I haven't timed myself. I'm so sorry, Mr. Jim. Yeah, Jimmy.
Jimmy, yeah.
I'm blind with glasses. I'm sorry.
But the one on Michelle Sellers' event when I first saw your performance, I think that must have been like 10 minutes.
Well, I just hold it for two today.
Two?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to time myself just for you one day.
Yes, you need to.
Okay.
But is it Kenny G who's done it the longest?
I think somebody beat him, actually.
Oh, really? Well, yeah. Kenny G did like 45 minutes holding a note.
I think this guy did like 47.
Ah.
Yeah.
Check that out. That's incredible.
I ain't came nowhere close to that. I'm just letting you know.
You could have lied and said you could, but we haven't got time for it.
No. Nah, nope. So you want to hear that last one?
Yes, please.
All right. Uh-oh. I didn't cut it down the first time, see? I'm going to get better at this thing, I'm telling you. Practice makes perfect. This ain't practice.
Oh, Chi-Chi says she loves your accent.
Oh, man. That's called country. Thank you, though. Let's go. We'll be right back.
Incredible.
It's still going, because I'll be still going, but we got to cut it short today.
Yeah, bless you. It was wonderful to see that live. It really was.
Thank you.
Yeah. And is it circular breathing that you have to do?
Circular breathing.
And how long did it take you to perfect that?
Well, it took me about 17 years to actually get the method.
Right.
And probably like another year to actually try to perfect the tone. Mm-hmm. You know, now we digital, y'all can really hear our tone. So we got to really concentrate. Yeah. Live is a lot easier, but.
Just incredible. Absolutely incredible.
Thanks for having me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rhoda G. And people can follow you on Facebook.
Oh, yeah. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. I'm not on Twitter that much, although I need to up my Twitter game. But RhodaG.com is the website.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
We're going to see about getting these on there.
Yeah, it'll be great. Thank you again. You have been sensational.
Thanks for having me. And thank you too, Miss Michelle, for introducing me and making this connection happen. Yes, I appreciate it.
We will be in touch.
Yes, and most definitely.
Yeah, and I look forward to hearing more music from you real soon.
Stay tuned.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you, Spider. He's just put that in the chat, your website link, rhodag.com. Yes. And another round of applause for you because you deserve it.
Aww.
Thank you.